Those enjoying the sunshine outside should come on in. This is our last session. So in the front row, I'm going to thank Ruth Katz and Peggy Clark, the two health people who put it together. Thank you all. And I can think of no better person to conclude this meeting than Kathleen Sebelius, the 21st Secretary of Health and Human Services, a person who helped bring us the Affordable Care Act, but also somebody who has been a great manager, managed the state of Kansas for 8 years, right?
Almost
8 years. But I'm going to start with a slightly offbeat question, being from New Orleans. Is it true you've been to Jazz Fest for 35 years?
Yes.
And who's your favorite band?
It's hard to have a favorite.
The Neville Brothers.
Neville's come close, but Irma Thomas is hard to beat, you know?
I will say I was there at the very beginning of Jazz Fest when I was young, and Irma Thomas used to always end it with "It's Raining, If It Was Raining," or one of her...
Raining So Hard.
Anyway, let's thank you very much for being here, and welcome to civilian life. How's it going?
Thank you. So far, so good. I'm finding out what all of you do every day, which is really terrific.
Let's talk about the Affordable Care Act. First of all, let's start with what the good side is, the upside, what you are pleased by, and the things we may not know about how it's worked.
Well, I think there has been a lot of focus on this final phase of the Affordable Care Act, which was the marketplace that really affects a limited number of people in the private insurance market, those who had no insurance coverage at all through their workplace, and finally had a stream of federal money to help subsidize their individual purchase of health insurance, the way employers help subsidize employees' purchase of health insurance, and people in the small group market. So it's about 11 million people, potentially, who were in that space of individually insuring their coverage or small business owners, and then 40-plus million uninsured who might have an opportunity either through Medicaid or Medicare. That has been a lot of the conversation, but I would say, Walter, the Affordable Care Act really started 4 years ago and began with some very dramatic changes, improvements in the overall structure of health insurance. 6 months into the program, families could keep an up to 26-year-old on their family plan. About 3 million young adults took advantage of that. Some of you may have children, as you said you do. I did in that age category. We had changes with the insurance companies no longer being able to eliminate coverage for children with pre-existing condition. Huge issue for millions of parents in this country. Medicare benefits began to change, adding wellness visits and preventive care without copays. Those pieces of the puzzle began to go into place really 3.5 years ago. Then, you know, building up to a real marketplace, the fear that I had from the beginning was that we wouldn't potentially have a market. Because what you were asking is insurance companies essentially to bid blind on who might come into this market, how many people, how successful it would be. They had to set rates that would be competitive, not knowing if the risk pool would be really adversely selected. We knew that older and sicker people who might be locked out of the market altogether or might be locked in a very expensive plan would come in. But how to attract young and healthy people so you would have a balance.
Did that work out?
It actually did. At the end of the day, there are over 35% under 35 in the new marketplaces out of the 8 million folks. And I think it's all the insurance companies tell me that they beat their target populations.
So how will the premiums be this November?
Well, what we're seeing already in some preliminary data before the states, now insurance is still regulated at the state level, and insurance commissioners have the opportunity to look at initial rates and then go back and review them. And what we're seeing right now is very modest increases, well under the double-digit increases that were projected. And in some cases, they're announcing that the rates are coming in at actually a decrease. And we're seeing more companies wanting to come into the market. Some of the areas in the country where there were a limited number of companies now are seeing some real competition.
Are we going to get more state exchanges?
I think that's unclear. The financing of setting up your own exchange at this point, if the exchange is up and running, is pretty daunting. And
is
they
that
only
good
have
or bad?
Until.
I mean, does it really matter?
I think at this point it really doesn't matter.
What about states that opted out of doing the Medicaid thing? Are more going to get in, and is it a big difference?
Well, Medicaid really does matter. And I think it is unconscionable that still in some states around the country, unconscionable. I think the financial case for playing politics with people's lives is going to overwhelm the politics. We have 36 governor's races this year. There are a number of Republican governors who I know are eager to do this and needed to get beyond their primary or even into the general. But right now, there are billions of dollars of federal money on the table and millions, about 5 million people who are too poor to get any financial assistance for health care. It's outrageous. And some of the biggest states in the country, Florida and Texas, come to mind. Texas particularly, where 25% of Texans have no health insurance at all. And Texas is still sitting
and
there.
And what is that rate nationally, especially for states where there is a Medicaid opt-in?
Well, some 25%. States are now driving their rates below 10% into the 5% margin, and I think we'll see more of that. Michigan just started enrolling, but I think you're going to see, I mean, Massachusetts is at 97-98% of people with coverage, and I think
thanks
that's
to Governor
what you'll
Romney,
see.
Though, we'll say.
You bet. Romney Care works. Who knew?
What about changing the cost curve?
Well, I know people might have heard Peter Orszag yesterday talk about this a little bit, and I know you've had some financial sessions in the past, but I think this is the untold story of the Affordable Care Act. Beyond coverage, and there are now about 22 million people with affordable coverage thanks to the Affordable Care Act, and that's a big deal, and that number will grow. The cost story is even more dramatic. Costs in healthcare are rising at the lowest level in 50 years. And that's not just in the private insurance market, which is true. Medicare costs have never been lower. They were rising at an average of about 6% a year in the 9 years before the ACA. They're now down under 2%. If the government and the private sector are able to keep the cost increase of healthcare below GDP costs, it's about a $400 billion savings by 2017 and a $4 to $5 trillion savings by 2024.
By the way,
changes
to put that
the
in
economics.
Perspective, that's more than Simpson-Bowles would have saved us.
Well, it changes the economics of this country.
And why is it happening? I mean, give us the different components.
I think there's a lot going on. I was saying earlier, you know, to me, this exercise is a bit like synchronized swimming, and there's a lot of focus on the bathing caps, and that to me is the market. But what's going on underneath the surface of the water is really much more dramatic. But we don't have underwater cameras, so most people can't see that. So here are the pieces that have happened since 2009. The Recovery Act had a big incentive for doctors and hospitals to take up electronic medical records. In 2008, fewer than 9% of hospitals and fewer than 20% of doctors used any kind of comprehensive electronic record. Now think of this. This is a $2 trillion industry exchanging information on paper files in 2008. I mean, you wouldn't have a mom-and-pop grocery store that would do an inventory.
But we still do that.
But it's changing. We now have 80% of hospitals and over 50% of docs. That means you can finally see what's going on. You can measure what's going on. You can figure that out. You add to that some pieces of tobacco regulation and a real focus on obesity that has come with this administration, the two underlying causes of a lot of chronic health conditions. So you begin to drill down on that. You add to that, I think, some efforts underway for the first time with the passage of the ACA to do real research and development through the Innovation Center on what really works. You know, the head of Mount Sinai is here. We chatted on the way in, one of the best hospital systems in the country. But they're really looking at ways that they can improve quality and lower costs. That's always been the case. But drilling down on just things like preventable readmissions dropping for the first time. Patient safety is beginning to really show signs of improvement. The whole accountable care organizations with doctors and hospitals coming together in different variations to both look at ways to lower costs and improve care, but also to share savings for the first time. That's all underway. So initially they said this is all about recession. It's all, you know, the first couple of years, it's all recession. I think every health economist and a lot of outside experts would say this is clearly beginning to be institutional change that's underway, and I think will be accelerated.
But we could, everybody so far in this conference has been, one of the underlying themes is you can't really have true institutional change until you move away from fee-for-service.
You bet. But that's one of the big pieces of the puzzle. So the Affordable Care Act gave Medicare, for the first time, the following authorities. If a protocol is tested, accountable care organizations, or putting the disincentive in place for readmitting people who shouldn't be back in, if something works, you can take it to scale. No longer is there a demonstration project run by 3 years in a certain part of the country, come back to Congress and ask for permission. It can be taken to scale by just turning up the dial. And that's what is about to happen with a real accelerated move to away from fee-for-service into bundled payments, medical protocol around medical home models, the sickest, oldest folks who are dealing with chronic conditions being able to be treated in a coordinated care strategy, looking at cost outliers. And for the first time, Medicare can say, you know, we're not going to pay any longer for this. And I got to tell you, one of the things that is really going to accelerate this is the private sector's eagerness to, as payers, to be part of this. They've been trying to move for fee-for-service for years. Medicare has been the drag. As long as Medicare paid for things, the more you do, the more you get paid, the more stuff that happens, you know, the more days you spend in a hospital. So it doesn't really matter if you're there for a hospital-acquired infection that was caused by what happened to you in the hospital, you get paid more by staying more days. Those days are over.
To give a shout-out to the Aspen Institute, your successor, Sylvia Burwell Matthews Burwell, is a Henry Crown Fellow of the Aspen Institute. What note did you leave in the desk saying, here's what you ought to do?
I left a note in the desk saying, I'm going to Aspen. Good luck. Sylvia and I had worked together closely over the year she's been the director of OMB, and I would say she has been a terrific advocate for the various needs of HHS. We're not only one of the biggest domestic agencies, we have a $1 trillion budget, but in case you didn't notice, there's been a little controversy around the Affordable Care Act with members of Congress. And one of the things that has been very challenging is trying to get the resources to actually run the program without necessarily having line items that say Affordable Care Act administrative costs, because that's easy to then have adversaries cross out. So she's been terrific, and I think she understands not only the broad assets of the department, but also the needs to make sure that the marketplace continues to run and that we have a robust program. And she'll be terrific. We worked together for a while during her confirmation process, and then as she took the reins of the department.
So if there were a situation in Washington, which there isn't, where things that are wrong could be fixed, give us a list of the three or four things that you would fix now in the Affordable Care Act.
Well, I think if you look at some of the regulatory issues that we had, we had to use a blunt instrument to have a smoother runway for those who, for instance, had coverage who were transitioning into the market, small business owners who were coming newly into the market, some of the business challenges of reporting. They should be fixed. We could only either use enforcement discretion and just say we're rolling off these regs for a year or two, or implement them right away, because no one had the appetite to open up the Affordable Care Act and try to fix them. So there are definitely pieces of the overall structure that need to be fixed. I think insurance companies are pretty pleased with the framework of the overall market, but there are still some challenges, and I think need to keep a careful eye on particularly parts of the country where the market may not be so robust, making sure that you don't have companies who come in who are eager to be good partners only to have them driven out of business because the marketplace...
Sorry, give me an example of what, specifically of how that might happen.
Well, if, for instance, we had a situation in New Hampshire where there was basically only one company who came into the marketplace, and there was a real difficulty. They had a very narrow network, a very difficult time. That's going to change now because they're going to have some competitors, but you run the risk of, in a monopoly, this was trying to get away from monopoly marketplaces and let competition with companies, and I'm a free market believer. It's ironic how many of the adversaries of this act really don't like the free market strategies, okay? Letting people choose coverage, having insurance companies compete for price and service, which they've never had to do. They've actually been able to cherry pick a marketplace. But if you allowed that to continue for very long, you could really put people in a far worse situation than they are. So I think it's important in states where the take-up has been relatively low. We know that take-up is likely to be older and sicker, and to prop up those companies so that you can wait a year or two and get the enrollment higher so that the market actually works.
You've run for governor twice in Kansas and won, proving you're a good politician. If you were Mary Landrieu, if you were you running in Kansas, would you now, as a Democrat, think that the Affordable Care Act cuts for you or against you?
Well, I think that it is a, it first of all is the law. Secondly, I think having the debate about whether or not, as a country, we should provide health insurance to all the people in the country is a debate well worth having. I had it in Kansas for years, and people respond well. I mean, they actually understand the notion that having a group population outside of the healthcare system isn't good. It isn't morally conscionable, and it isn't economically sensible, because you're paying for those folks in a very expensive way as they come through the emergency room doors, as they access the system in the most expensive, least effective way, or as they live under a bridge because they don't have mental health and substance abuse services, or they're in county and city jails. I mean, taxpayers are paying for those costs. If you explain to people what is going on, my experience is that they're very responsive. And I think Leader McConnell has just given us the best political insight into this. As some of you know, he's on the ballot this time. that the Kentucky Connector, their own health exchange, has actually worked very well. There are now about 450,000 Kentuckians mm-hmm. who have care now with this system. The vast majority had no health insurance before, either through Medicaid or the marketplace. Recently, Mitch McConnell said he is all for repealing Obamacare. He thinks it's terrible, the worst thing that's ever happened, but he thinks the Kentucky Connector should stay in place, and that's pretty good.
Would the Kentucky Connector exist without the Affordable
Absolutely
Care Act?
Absolutely not. It is Obamacare. It is. But what Leader McConnell doesn't know is who those 450,000 people are, or who their aunts and uncles are, who their parents are. So it's very dangerous right now in Kentucky, I would suggest, to go out and rail against the Kentucky Connector, because then you're talking about my kids, or me, or my son and daughter-in-law, or my mother who has never had insurance before, who now has care. That's happening all over the country.
And do you think it's helping the economy by allowing people to switch jobs when they were maybe trapped in a job?
Well, the irony of employer-based coverage, which is uniquely American, and it did two things. I think it provided a way for employers to recruit and retain great employees. And small business owners would tell me every day that's their best strategy to keep a great workforce, is having good health benefits. It was more important than salary and wages. But they found themselves over and over again, particularly in the small group market, being more and more disadvantaged by the big guys. They didn't have big HR departments. They couldn't negotiate the better rates. And they were finding that their core product, whatever it was suffering because of the time and energy they were spending trying to keep a health plan together. They are now freed up. They can now make economic choices that make sense, and I would say drive the economy. And certainly for workers, having a choice, you look at whether it's young adults coming out of school or out of their parents' plans who can choose a profession that they might like, not based on where they're going to get health care. You can have people move jobs, change jobs, start their own businesses. Again, I have people who stop me every day who say, you know, I always wanted to open my own childcare center. I always wanted to see if I could make a go of my baked goods operation, but I was terrified because I couldn't get health care.
The theme of this conference is 2024 because it's our 10th anniversary. We're looking 10 years ahead. Looking 10 years ahead, will we still have fee-for-service and will we still be mainly dependent on employee-based health care?
I hope, and I think it's a very good likelihood that fee-for-service will be a thing of the past. And I think you're going to see that. I know there's an effort underway right now to see what can be locked in by December of 2016. And the tools are there to do that, so you make that shift. And frankly, if Medicare moves, the market moves. Medicare has contracts with virtually...
That's right. Locked in by 2016, meaning before he leaves
rules
office.
Rules and... You bet.
You put rules and reg before the next...
Just to make sure that
you're
the
worried that
drive
Hillary
is underway.
Will reverse it?
My guess is she'll step on the gas, yeah. But, you know, there are uncertainties still in this world. So I think fee-for-service is done, and I think that that's a very good thing. And I think that employer-based coverage will be more of an economic choice of employers as opposed to a necessity. Where they'll make a decision, is this good for our core business? Does this enhance what we're trying to do? And if not, we're going to contribute to the overall health care coverage of our employees and focus on our core business. And employees, for the first time, will have some choices that they don't have today. And that's all very good.
Here's the biggest downside people are talking about that will hit the Affordable Care Act and the health care system in the next couple of years politically, which is when people discover that they just can't get a particular treatment because it's not economically efficient, that under the old system with fee-for-service and your gold-plated plans, you could say, I want knee replacements and, you know, everything else. but we're going to have to stop that. And whenever you get near there, you get people raising death panels and all sorts of things. How do we get out of that discussion?
Well, first of all, I think it is mythology that most people had any kind of insurance that would cover everything they wanted. I mean, it just didn't happen. I spent 8 years as an insurance commissioner. I fought with insurance companies every day to try and get the benefits that consumers were entitled to paid for. And insurance companies always stood between a doctor and the patient, always. So I think the good old days really are somewhat mythical. Medicare, on the other hand, paid for a lot of fixed benefits, but in a somewhat, I would say, nonsensical way. My best favorite example is Medicare would cover the costs associated with an amputation and all of the follow-up costs and all of the follow-up treatment related to that amputation based on an accelerated diabetes condition. They would not provide services to prevent the amputation from ever occurring, the kind of wraparound care that that person might need. So it was a very strange fee-for-service. You had a benefit, but the benefits, no smoking cessation for the vast majority of people who didn't have lung cancer yet. Once you got lung cancer, you got smoking cessation efforts. But a lot of the preventive care initiatives, a lot of the focus just wasn't there. So again, I understand the difficulty of rationing care, but if we have a system, here's one of the things that happens with electronic medical records. Not only do you finally see what's going on, and measure it, and compare across the country, and compare within a town, and compare within a system. Consumers, for the first time, will own their own medical records. Think of that. It's more difficult often to get your own medical records from anybody than to, you know, fly to the moon. You can't, nobody will tell you what's in them, nobody. And you finally will have a consumer voice in healthcare. If data is available, and HHS has just put out the 1,000th data dump in this administration, finally putting data into the marketplace that is available, it's free, it can be used by entrepreneurs, it can be used by individuals, and consumers can say, why is my doctor choosing a knee joint for me that costs 1,000% more than this knee joint, which is used in this hospital across town, and there's no improvement in quality. Why is that going on? I wanna talk about that. I want a change in that. The health system can look at that. Atul Gawande is famous for saying, you know, if the Cheesecake Factory can retrain chefs on menus and teach them to cook different things all the time, why in the world can't we have protocol that keeps up with times in the healthcare system?
HHS does a whole lot more than just the Affordable Care Act. What are a couple of the things that you've been doing at HHS that you think particularly significant?
Well, there is a lot going on. It's a 90,000 person organization, 11 agencies, everything from the Food and Drug Administration, which regulates 25 cents of every consumer dollar, to NIH, the gold standard in research in the world, to all the children and family programs. So there's a lot going on in the early childhood space around improving and expanding Head Starts, home visitation, looking at ways that you really get kids off to a healthy start by the time they're 3 years old and close that learning gap. The mental health parity, long overdue, is very much underway, looking at how you actually make sure that mental health services are delivered in the same way that physical health services are, and that we get rid of the stigmas around that. FDA, for the first time, is putting together a new food safety regimen, 40 years overdue, and that will have significant impact on not only what consumers have on their table, but what kind of economic impact that has on the global marketplace.
By the way, am I supposed to eat butter now? I can't remember.
Go for it.
Let me open it up to questions. Start with Ken Davis since he got the shout out, but I see the hands over there too. Yeah, here.
So, you got it.
It's so a filibuster.
There was a lot of controversy around the public option when the bill was being evolved, and it didn't make it to the finish line. As you look to 2024, as you see the exchanges develop, do you think there's a possibility that could come back? And if not, just tell us your thoughts on whether the exchange would be more viable if we had a public option.
I don't know how to answer the second part of that question because it's a hard balance. The president, I think, decided after a lot of debate that, first of all, lots of people just wanted to go to a single payer system from the outset. If we're going to have comprehensive health reform, that's where we should be. And that would mean that about 180 million Americans who had private employer-based health insurance would start all over again. He made the determination that that probably was not feasible or viable. And if anybody has watched this debate, I think he probably made the right call on that. Closing the gap was first. So then the public option became the fallback in addition to having private insured choices. I'd say, Ken, that we're in half of the states in the country, there is a co-op being set up, and it is as close to the public option as you might get. Breaking up the monopoly market and having a new insurance option available, which is really more patient-owned and company-owned, and that has been pretty successful in those states. The co-op sign-up in the first year has been robust in the states where it exists, and it also is often the lowest priced option in the market. Whether they can sustain that, whether they have the viability, will still be determined. I think you're also going to see Vermont is creating, has a public, a direct public option in their marketplace strategy. So we're going to see some models of what works. And I think there's going to be more and more pressure as people get coverage to drive the administrative costs out of the private insurers. Right now, Medicare runs at about a 3% administrative overhead, 3%. Private insurance companies are somewhere in the 15 to 30% range. So if you think about that, you can deliver health services much more efficiently, much more effectively than a lot of private insurance companies do. There is the 80-20 rule that now says if you don't spend 80% of the dollars that come in on health services, you owe consumers money back. And millions of Americans got checks back from their insurance companies the last 3 years based on that. So there is some efficiency underway, but I think you're going to see a lot more of it with market competition and with the co-ops and some of this private option coming into play.
To put a push on Ken's point, though, you're out of office now federally. If you were a governor, would you be pushing for a public option or co-op option in your state?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. I mean, again, I'm a believer that competition is the best driver of marketplace strategies. And to take, if you can have a private insurer who wants to run on a 5% overhead, have at it. But if you're at 30% and you have 60% of the market, that is not good for consumers in any way, shape, or form.
Did you want to follow up, Ken?
No, I think that's a great point. I'd like to follow up with a completely different issue.
And I'll get to Ray in a second and others. Yeah, go ahead.
The administration is very concerned appropriately. The
administration is very concerned, as are many of us in healthcare, appropriately about obesity. Yet the paradox of high fructose corn syrup in so many products is that we subsidize corn. Are we ready to really take a political stand and do something about that?
You're asking a former governor of Kansas. Let's see how she answers.
Well, since Tom Vilsack is not in the room, we grow much more wheat in Kansas than corn. He's the corn boy from Iowa.
Maybe. Is Vilsack
no,
here?
He left. Okay. I checked it out this morning. It makes no sense. We also subsidize tobacco, by the way. Just saying. It makes absolutely no sense. But the likelihood of this Congress tackling that issue, I don't think is very good. So then you go to the fallback position, which is educating consumers about what they're eating and what it does to their bodies, updating the nutrition facts, which was done this year, updating the overall food plate to get information to consumers, having front of package labeling that is much more clear and easy to read. The FDA is moving into that space, and I think that's all going to be very helpful. But spending taxpayer dollars on something that's driving, again, high costs in healthcare and shorter lifespan makes no sense at all.
Is that Ray? I can't see. Yeah.
Hi, yeah. Madam Secretary. Good to see you. Ray Suarez nice from Al Jazeera. The Hobby Lobby decision is expected on Monday. And I know that, actually, I've interviewed you on the subject of employers being able to choose what services are available because of their own religious convictions. If the court rules that that's possible, play out how that changes the way the system operates. And if it decides you can't do that, play out how that will work. Because for a lot of places, it's going to be a big deal.
Well, again, I'm not the litigator. I do think this issue is far beyond contraception coverage in the Affordable Care Act, which, by the way, has provided about 50 million women in America affordable contraception coverage. Probably the biggest sea change in women's health ever. This really is about whether or not employers based on religious views can pick and choose which federal laws to follow and not follow. On behalf of their employees, I think it is a having for the first time private employers be able to claim religious freedom to make choices about the federal law has huge ramifications. It certainly will have some impact on the Affordable Care Act, but far broader than that is an impact on all kinds of laws. Should a private employer who doesn't believe in the war be able to opt out of any kind of strategies about taxes? Should somebody have an opportunity to say, you know, I don't feel that this is part of my religion, that we would follow a certain practice and opt out of a federal law? So I think it's very troubling in terms of the overall freedom of religion emphasis and the balance between the public square and the private square in terms of religion has been a fundamental part of our democracy for a long time. This would blur the lines in, I think, a very serious way. So I don't know what the court is likely to do based on their past examples, although many of the most conservative judges have been very firm about this principle. We'll see where the case may take on Monday.
Right there, just shout it out. Our mic runners are a bit slow. Yeah. Yeah.
Is there an objective to get healthcare down to around common Western world standards of 12% of GDP, and can we get there without a single payer system?
Well, I think the trend line is very much there in terms of if we could sustain what has happened in the last 4 years in terms of the cost curve. We will totally change the economics of this country. If the United States contains health costs to below GDP per capita average, it will be the first time in 50 years that that has happened, and it changes what the projections are into the future. There's no question that we still overpay for lots of what we do compared to other countries. We do have pockets of some of the best care in the world, where people come here from all over the world to access care. We also have some really mediocre care going on day in and day out and being paid for on a regular basis. So our health results, if our health results were dazzling, the spending two times what any other country on earth spends on health care might make a value proposition. But they're not dazzling. We look like a recovering country when you look at everything from infant mortality rates to length of life to treatment on various kinds of chronic diseases. We just don't do very well as a country. So I think it's both looking at the overall cost, but getting much better protocol for what we're paying for, evening out that kind of care.
Oh, is there a mic? Oh, thank you. So I really love your synchronized swimming analogy, and I think one of the things in this conversation that is underneath the water is not just how much we're spending on healthcare, but how much we're spending on other social policies that are related to health. And so if you look across nations, we are spending double what other people are spending, but if you combine health and social expenditures, we're spending about the same. The ratio is different. So I'm just interested in your perspective on what the opportunities are. It's not just bending the cost curve. It's stopping the rationing of health.
Well, that's a great point. I see Howard Koh here. Howard has...
Howard, stand up.
Howard is the Assistant Secretary of Health at HHS. Spectacular job. Howard has been revitalizing, and this is just by way of example, our whole effort on environmental health issues, because the cost of breathing polluted air and drinking polluted water and has enormous health cost impact, as well as mortality impact on our individuals. But we had really stopped that effort in the whole department of HHS. It was pretty sleepy. We don't look very carefully when we talk about young children and a healthy start with young children. We certainly, having prenatal care widely available is really important. Certainly having aggressive outreach and home visiting is important. But having some sort of sensible employer policies on maternity and paternity leave, which every other Western country in the world has, also has a huge impact on how well those babies do. If a mom has to go back to work 4 weeks after or 3 weeks after that baby is born, and she doesn't have a lot of resources and she doesn't have a lot of options for good, affordable childcare, that child is less likely to be healthy as he or she starts out than a child who has those wraparound services. So I think you're absolutely right, whether it's environmental issues or policy issues around the social determinants of health, we don't spend a lot of time in this country thinking about it. We allocate them all to the healthcare system, and then we overpay for people who are sicker or live shorter lives, die younger than their peers in any country on earth.
Madam Secretary, good morning. My name is Chris Gates, and what I'd love to know is something about leadership and what you've seen over the last couple of years, particularly with some of the challenges that the job has presented. what you've seen about leadership in general, and perhaps what you've seen about your own leadership as your own leadership has evolved.
Well, I think that leadership issues are important in terms of trying to mobilize folks to move in a similar direction in a federal agency. And I know this is not well understood. A department like Health and Human Services, 90,000 employees, we have a total of about 108 political appointees. And I say that because a new president coming in, you're trying to mobilize this huge federal government to move in a direction. Think about HHS, 11 agencies, 108 people who can be scattered across that environment in order to move in a different direction. And I would suggest there was a lot of interest in moving in a different direction from the prior administration. Without skills to actually involve and engage the people in those agencies, set a mission course, reinforce it, and then try to actually implement it, you're dead in the water. Nothing ever happens. There's a little conversation up here and nothing moves. So being a governor was actually good training to be a cabinet secretary because it's a lot of similar rhythm. I had cabinet departments in as a governor, similar to having these agencies. Tried to recruit and retain superstars the way I did as governors, but the superstars at this level were just dazzling. People who, you know, came from all kinds of walks of life, well below market value, to work harder than they've ever worked in their lives because they wanted to be part of this administration. But then mobilizing that team and trying to make sure that those talents were used and empowered and moved in the right direction is a continuous challenge. I sure made some mistakes along the way in terms of, you know, focusing on some things and not on others. I was terrified as we looked at the rollout of the health plan that we actually wouldn't have a market. That was my biggest focus and fear, and spent a lot of time and energy with insurers, with consumers, with my old colleagues at the insurance commissioner's offices trying to make sure we had companies who actually came into the market. Too little time, clearly, on the technology side, on making sure that what I was hearing was actually accurate and getting enough eyes and ears on that. But each of those was a learning experience. And I think at the end of the day, you know, for me, what we had to do then is double down. I mean, you had a rocky, flawed 8-week period that actually we did some very ugly beta testing along the way, which was helpful to then make sure that it was up and running and that the market worked, and we ended up with 8 million people enrolled, beating the targets. But the president's leadership, I had an interesting experience. I'd been an insurance commissioner, so I ran my own agency, answered to the voters. Been a governor, ran my own state, answered to the voters. Got here and found myself in the first couple months saying to people, you know, well, we're gonna go do this, and they would say, psst, we're going to talk to the president about whether or not we're going to do this. I was like, oh, yeah, there's that. I hadn't had a boss. Who knew? I hadn't had a boss in a long time. And I actually liked the boss. I came to work for the boss, but remembering that was a little struggling. And that is a difficult tension, again, because at the White House, they're looking at all the departments and all the agencies and whether or not, I mean, corn syrup is a great example. We've had a number of discussions with colleagues who saw the world from a different lens, who had a constituency they were looking out for, who had a different impact. So we were the public health guys, but sometimes that conflicted with the economic team who said, if you go down this path, this will be disastrous. And resolving those kinds of things, and ultimately that's the president's call when you have agencies. So there are, I guess, various levels of leadership. What happens at the agency level? How to mobilize that to focus on three or four or five priorities across the board, how to make sure employees are empowered and feel part of it. I was really pleased that while we were struggling through very difficult times and some difficult battles, our employee satisfaction rate actually was on the rise, not the fall. They felt like they were in part of something historic. They were at the front lines of change, and they felt proud to be there each and every day.
Well, let me take this issue, though, and raise it to the big issue in Washington, which is one of the challenges and perhaps failures of leadership on the Affordable Care Act was that it became a partisan rather than nonpartisan. Was that inevitable, and is Washington ever going to have a way to do things like healthcare in a nonpartisan way? And what type of leadership would that take?
Well, I think there was great hope in 2009 that we would have a more bipartisan congressional effort. And the House had one Republican vote at the end of the day, in spite of three committees taking literally hundreds of Republican suggestions. The framework, as we said earlier, was Romney Care in Massachusetts, which was a different strategy than a lot of the president's supporters would have liked to have seen. Go for a single payer, go for a mandatory public option. He was trying to juggle and balance in hopes that that would bring some bipartisan support. On the Senate side, Senator Baucus, Chairman Baucus, felt that working with this small group of bipartisan senators, which went over a four-month period of time, would produce some Republican votes. At the end of the day, it didn't. Could leadership have done something different? I don't know, but I gotta tell you that it was not through lack of effort. I don't know that Congress, what I think is most disturbing, Walter, though, is, so the bill is passed. Clearly a lot of difficulty with a partisan effort. I kept thinking, and this is based on a lot of years in politics where the pragmatist takes over. Okay, this is the law, we're gonna make it work. Never happened. I thought, okay, after the Supreme Court case, people would say, it's now constitutional, we're gonna make it work. Didn't happen. Okay, the election. This is a president who clearly had staked a big claim on the health care bill, and the American public overwhelmingly reelected him. I thought that would end this hugely controversial. It didn't happen. So I've really never seen anything like this in my life, where it is very personal. It's very specific to this president, and healthcare, I think, is the way that a lot of adversaries have decided they would try to block and stop him when they could not win the election, when they didn't win the court case, and that continues on.
You're saying that the opposition to the Affordable Care Act is personally a dislike for Barack Obama?
It's a dislike for, I would say, his number one policy initiative. But if you recall, again, go back a few years, Leader McConnell said his most important job in the United States Senate was making sure there were no wins for this president.
Hi, Jessica Lucas, I'm from Kansas and help support both of your gubernatorial campaigns. My question is a little more pointed. Sam Brownback has taken our state in a much different direction than under your leadership, particularly his income tax cuts and the fact that our state is not embracing the expansion of Medicaid. What is your take on the state of Kansas since you've left, and will we see you get engaged with the Davis gubernatorial campaign, which recent polls show he is leading?
Well, I have watched carefully, and I'm in and out of Kansas all the time. My husband's a federal judge. He's still on the bench in Kansas. Kansas is my home residency state, pay taxes there, own a home there, and am really dismayed by what has happened in a very short period of time. I left Kansas in April of 2009, having been pretty overwhelmingly reelected in 06. So it hasn't been decades since Kansans have elected a Democrat statewide, and that the policies really that people seem to support for years have really been slashed. As you say, the most difficult thing right now to watch is a slashing of the revenue stream, which was pretty balanced and focused in large part on support for education, support for science and innovation. And this recent prediction is that the revenues of the state based on the tax cut that was passed are 45% lower than they were a year ago. Stunning. And I think that's why you see the gubernatorial race. A poll out last week said that the Democratic challenger is leading the incumbent governor 47 to 41 if they were head-on-head today. I think that's an indication that Kansas voters are not thrilled with what's going on, and I think that's very encouraging.
Might you run for office in Kansas again?
Not a chance.
Dr. Feinberg, introduce yourself if you want.
Well, thank you very much.
I know, Harvey.
I know. Harvey Feinberg. Wait, we go.
Yes, thank you. I'm Harvey Feinberg from the Institute of Medicine. Thank you so much, Madam Secretary, for your leadership. We have really all benefited from it. We've talked a lot about the Affordable Care Act, the responsibilities of the department around health insurance and spreading the ability of people to get access. But I wanted to ask you about two other dimensions. The responsibilities around the prevention of disease through the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and the responsibilities for discovery through the NIH and our lead agency for biomedical research in the nation. These are two agencies, the one of which has been continuously reduced in its resources over the past years, and the other of which has been kept essentially flat over a decade. How can we make a more powerful, persuasive argument to our leadership that the nation needs to emphasize both the prevention of disease before it starts and the discovery of new ways to treat and prevent disease in the future?
And this is going to be our last question. So that's a big, broad question. So take it where you will.
Well, Harvey, first of all, I want to recognize Harvey's leadership at the IOM. He is stepping down in the not-too-distant future, but has done a terrific job and has been a wonderful collaborator and partner looking at a lot of these significant issues. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention may be the least well-understood health agency, but it's the backbone of public health in this country. And as Harvey said, has been systematically reduced in budget authority. The good news is that the Affordable Care Act had, for the first time, a stream of money dedicated to prevention, the so-called Prevention Fund. Unfortunately, it has had to be used in large part to backfill what Congress has done to the CDC. And the CDC is our surveillance system, our health system, not only here in the country, but globally. And I know Tom Frieden was here talking a little bit about the Global Health Security Initiative. If we want to keep Americans safe and secure, if we want better public health in this country, we have to pay attention to what's happening around the globe, and CDC is very involved in that. That's an education issue that has to go on day and night, where people understand how critical it is to monitor outbreaks, how important it is to drive public health, and how important it is to focus on data points that tell us what's going on and what's harmful to Americans. NIH, on the other hand, I think is not only the gold standard in this country, but in the world for medical research. And we have research collaborations going on all across the globe. There was a big influx of new NIH money in the Recovery Act, but that produce a bell curve, which in some ways may have been more difficult than a gradual increase over that period of time. I am so tired of the politicians who say the following: I love the NIH. I love research. I am all for this. I'm for accelerating cures. I am for, you know, finding the next great breakthrough. And yet I'm going to vote for sequestration. I'm going to slash the federal budget. I'm going to diminish federal resources. NIH is 40% of the discretionary budget of the Department of Health and Human Services, 40%. There is no way you can decrease the budget of Health and Human Services and not hurt NIH. It just can't be done. The math doesn't work. We have to stand up, I think, as taxpayers and say, nothing could be worse in this economy, looking into the future, than cutting research and innovation in this day and age. And you can't do it without new money. We need new money at the table. So we need to both put CDC back where it belonged, but also fund research and innovation, which countries all around us, our global competitors, understand, which is why they're doubling down on research dollars right now, as we are leveling out of research dollars. It is dangerous for our country. It's bad for young scientists who are moving overseas so that they can do the kind of research and grants that they want. And it's just, frankly, a stupid economic proposition. Makes no sense.
Secretary Sebelius, thank you for coming. Thank you for your service to the nation. Appreciate it.